Over time, I've assembled many crazy PCs. Top processors for the consumer segment like 13900K, 14900K, 7950X3D, graphics cards like RTX 4090 or RX 7970XTX, mounted vertically in cases that are eye-catching or, on the contrary, more discreet and office-like, and I struggled last year with that cursed DDR5, which gave me grey hairs every chance it got. But today I will present to you what it is undoubtedly the most powerful system I've ever built, and by far the most expensive to date. It is a true sleeper, which from the outside gives almost no indication, maybe with the exception of the imposing dimensions, of what hides under the hood. Let's open the hood anyway, and I'll tell you. This Corsair H150i Elite fridge barely hides a Threadripper from the 7000 series, the newest from AMD, by its name Threadripper 7970X, with only 32 cores and 64 threads. Obviously, this 350-watt consuming monster needed a motherboard, and I chose a Gigabyte TRX 50 Aero D. Armored with industrial quantities of radiators, the extended ATX format board has an impressive list of features, from dual Ethernet of 10 Gbps and 2.5 Gbps to Wi-Fi 7, two PCI Express 5.0 X16 slots, which really are X16, not like the newer practice of X16 slots that are only wired X4 or X8, a PCI Express 4.0 X16 slot, 4 M.2 slots for SSDs, and last but not least, support for up to 1 TB of DDR5 ECC registered memory in quad channel. The installed memory, there are only 128 GB, a value with which I had major problems on all other DDR5 platforms. Well, this is not just any DDR5, it is ECC registered. What does that mean? Without going into too much detail, ECC, or error correct in code, ensures the correctness of the data transmitted from memory, and that registered means that the electrical signal is more stable, the memory having additional circuits for data buffering. Of course, on the STR5 platform, 128 GB is something easy, and the system booted up with the 4 sticks of memory installed right away. Something I can't say about any consumer DDR5 platform we've tested so far. Storage is provided by a 2 TB Samsung 990 Pro SSD, a performer worthy of the platform, with transfer speeds of over 7000 MB per second. Okay, and now let's not skirt around the elephant in the room. The system houses 2 GB Aorus RTX 4090 Extreme Water Force graphics cards, that is, liquid-cooled. Why are there two? Because this system will be used in programs where performance scales linearly with the number of video cards. 2 cards, twice the performance. And why liquid cooled? That I think is obvious. The space between the cards would have generated heat dissipation problems in the case of air-cooled video cards. And now surely someone smart enough in the comments will ask why I didn't go for a custom liquid cooling solution. Don't tire your keyboard, because I'll answer now. I'm not a fan of custom liquid cooling. Yes, it looks spectacular and in some cases saves precious space, but it is extremely demanding, requires periodic maintenance, and in a productivity environment you can't afford to keep walking through service with your PC or have the plumber come and clean your pipes. Moreover, even if a custom system would have theoretically a larger cooling capacity, as you will see, heat is not a problem with these coolings. All-in-one cooling systems are sealed, so you have much fewer impurities in the system, don't require maintenance, and retain many of the advantages of custom systems. So I mounted the radiator from one card in front, the radiator from the other on the side, and the cooler for the processor on the ceiling, so as to pull air out of the case. For the nitpickers, we are still in trials with the system, and the configuration in which we did the test is as follows. Intake through the front, through the radiator of the first video card, and through the back, at the fan that is normally used for exhaust. The exhaust is done through the top and the side, where we have the radiator for the processor and the radiator for the second graphics card respectively. However, I will test other configurations to be sure that I choose the best cooling solution. The system is powered by one of the most reliable and high-quality power supplies on the market, the Seasonic Vertex of 1600 Watt with 80+ titanium certification, meaning over 94% efficiency. Do we really need those 1600 watts from the power supply? Well, the processor consumes 350 watt and each card 450. The power supply comes with two 12 volt H power outputs with 16 pins made exactly for this scenario. Two powerful graphics cards and an equally demanding processor. I've put the system under 100% load and had no stability issues, but I must admit I was a bit nervous about the electrical network in the studio. I've gathered all the components, as you can see, in a Corsair 7000D Airflow, a champion of versatility and build quality, one of the few cases that allow the mounting of three 360mm radiators. And since we've mentioned it, what can you use such a system for, which costs $10,000 and consumes 1500 watt? And the answer is simple. Anything. Maybe even 4K gaming, without a doubt, but it's a shame to use it for that. Where this beast excels is video editing, rendering, animation, making it an extremely useful tool for any professional in the creative field. The system will be used in animation and cinematography programs, Cinema 4D, Redshift, etc., where both the processor and the two graphics cards will be used to the max and will produce art and, of course, money. Why did we choose to present this PC? Sure, it is dedicated to a niche, and for that niche it's not even expensive, as long as you make money with it. But the reason we chose to present it, it is because the PC itself is an estimate of the point where hardware is at this moment. And now let's talk about performance, because in the end, that's what it's about, otherwise it's just a box full of expensive iron and cables. I've insulted the system with a few gaming tests for the sake of it, but most tests have obviously focused on productivity, to give you an idea of the advantages of such a system compared to one of, say, $5,000 with an i9-14900K and an RTX 4090. And I will start lightly with the Cinebench R23, where the 14900K scores between 38,000 and 40,000 points, depending on how hot you want it to be in your house. In the same Cinebench R23, Threadripper 7970X scored 65,000 points. That's 63% more than the Intel processor, which, mind you, consumes the same 350 watt in full load. Now, that's efficiency. It is interesting that the single-core performances are not superior to the Intel processor, but overall, it is hard to fight with 32 cores and 64 threads, as this Threadripper has. Here are the results in some specific tests. Those who work in the field will certainly interpret these scores correctly, but for the uninitiated, I will summarize. This PC is an excellent tool for rendering. In Blender, for example, with rendering on the processor, the scores are double compared to a system with Intel i9-14900K. As for the graphics card, in almost any comparative test of professional applications with a system with Intel i9-14900K and RTX 4090, the scores are also double for the PC with Threadripper and two RTX 4090s, which confirms the fact that in the respective professional applications, the performance increases directly proportional to the number of mounted graphics cards. I also tested the graphics cards in the usual benchmarks, 3D Mark and Superposition, but as you probably know, these tests do not use both graphics cards. Thus, in gaming scenarios, the benefit of a second RTX 4090 card is zero. In Port Royal, we achieved a score of 25,800 points, but in TimeSpy Extreme, we hit the limitations of the benchmark, which does not scale properly. In Unigine Superposition 4K Optimized, the score was 31,200 points versus 33,500 obtained by the PC with one RTX 4090 and a 14900K processor. So in games, the PC with Intel will be a few percent faster than this one. But as is normal, each configuration has its role, and there is no solution that is a champion at everything. However, we are talking about just a few FPS difference at 4K resolution, a difference that will not alter the already extremely good experience in any way. And let's not forget that during all this time, the other graphics card was bored in the slot, not being used. I conclude the test section with some results related to consumption and temperatures. For these types of tests, as well as stability tests, we use, among other things, a program called OCCT. This program is very useful when you want to comparatively test different systems, but also when you want to evaluate the health of your computer's cooling. Using a combination of tests, we maximally loaded both graphics cards and the processor, and monitored the parameters with OCCT. The processor reached a maximum of 92 degrees Celsius, below the limit of 95-96 degrees, where thermal management begins to limit performance. The graphics cards had different temperatures, which is normal in the configuration they were placed. Thus, the one that was pulling air from outside had a maximum temperature of 56 degrees Celsius, with 64 at the memories and 72 at the hotspot. And the one that was pushing air out of the case reached 63 degrees, with 74 degrees on memories and 77 at the hotspot. These temperatures are very low. For example, the hotspot can reach over 100 degrees before the thermal management of the board reduces frequencies. However, as I said earlier, we will continue to play with the configuration to find the optimal airflow. As for consumption, there is not much to say. The graphics cards each consumed 450 watt in tests, and the processor reached the limit of 350 and stayed there. If we add about 100 watts for the consumption of the other components, it results in a maximum power draw of about 1450 watt. Given the very good efficiency of the power supply, I estimate that this PC pulls approximately 1500 watt from the socket in full load. So, this is the most powerful PC we have ever assembled, and now tell me below in the comments section. How did you find this monster with Threadripper and two RTX 4090 video cards? Is the battle for the most powerful desktop processor over with the arrival of the AMD Threadripper 7000 series? Or is it too expensive to ever be considered as such? Thanks for watching today, and while you're here, please subscribe to our tiny channel for more. Until next time, I wish you good luck to you all.